Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a free, complete course for the CCNA. If you like these videos, please subscribe to follow along with the series. Also, please like and leave a comment, and share the video to help spread this free series of videos. Thanks for your help. Also, remember to sign up via the link in the description to get all of the lab files for this course, so you can try it out yourself in Packet Tracer. If you want more labs like these, I highly recommend picking up Boson's NetSim for the CCNA. It's a network simulator with tons of guided labs covering all of the topics you need to know for the CCNA. Click the link in the video description to check it out. In this lab, we'll practice configuring static NAT on R1. PCs 1, 2, and 3 have private IP addresses, so they are unable to access the internet. We need to configure NAT on R1 to allow them to use the internet. For example, to access 8.8.8.8, a DNS server. So let's do step 1, which is to ping from PC1 to 8.8.8.8. So from the CLI of PC1, I'll try that. Ping 8.8.8.8. It will take a bit of time for each ping to time out, but all 4 pings should fail. R1 will try to send the pings out over the internet, but the ISP will simply drop the traffic because of the private IP addresses. So let's get right into static NAT configuration on R1 in step 2. First, let's configure the inside and outside interfaces. Enable, conft, interface G00. Is this the inside or outside interface? Well, it's the interface connected to the internet, to the external network, so it's the outside interface. IP NAT outside. And next, interface G01. This interface is connected to the internal network, so IP NAT inside. Okay, next let's configure those static NAT mappings. Exit. So we'll map each PC's private IP to a public IP in the 100.0.0.0/24 subnet. I'll do PC1 first. IP NAT inside, source static, 172.16.0.1, and then I'll map it to 100.0.0.1. keeping the host portion the same to make it simple. Next, I'll hit the up arrow and change these addresses to 100.0.0.2 and 172.16.0.2 for PC2. And then do that again, 100.0.0.3 and 172.16.0.3 for PC3. And that's it. Our static NAT configuration is done. Exit. Now, before trying that ping again from PC1, let's check the NAT translations and statistics. Show IP NAT translations. Here you can see the 3 static mappings we just configured, mapping these inside local addresses to inside global addresses. Now let's check the statistics. Show IP NAT statistics. Okay, 3 total translations, and here are the outside and inside interfaces we configured. Now let's try some pings, and then we'll check the translations again after. First, I'll ping from PC1 to 8.8.8.8. Ping 8.8.8.8. Okay, the ping works this time. Then, step 4 says to ping google.com from each PC. I've configured 8.8.8.8 as the DNS server of each PC, so they should contact 8.8.8.8 to learn the IP of google.com, and then they should be able to ping google.com. So, ping google.com. Okay, it works. Now I'll try to ping Google from PC2. Ping google.com. Okay, it works here too. And finally, the same from PC3. Ping google.com. Okay, the ping works. So let's check the translations on R1. Show IP NAT translations. Okay, there are a lot of translations this time. Here you can see the static translations still in the table. Below them are 3 UDP translations, all for destination 8.8.8.8, port 53. These dynamic entries are for when PC 1, 2, and 3 used DNS to learn the IP of google.com. And all of these entries up above are for the pings. Notice, as I pointed out in the lecture, that the inside local address is translated to the inside global address, but the outside local and outside global addresses are the same. That's because we are only doing source NAT, not destination NAT. Okay, finally, step 5 is to clear the NAT translation table. So, the command is clear IP NAT translation, and then an asterisk. Now let's check which entries remain. Show IP NAT translations. All of the dynamic entries are gone, and only the static entries remain. As I mentioned in the lecture, the dynamic entries will time out after a certain period of time and be cleared from the table, but this command lets you manually clear them. Okay, so in this lab, we practiced configuring static source NAT. That's all for this lab. Next, let's take a look at a bonus practice lab from Boson Software's NetSim for CCNA. Okay, here's today's Boson NetSim practice lab. So the lab I have selected is Static NAT 1. So in Boson NetSim for CCNA, there are 5 different NAT labs, and 2 of them cover static NAT. So here is the lab topology, and it looks like we are going to configure NAT here on router 4, because it's connected to what seems like an internet router, and this is its internal network with switch 1, switch 2, and 2 PCs, PC1 and PC3. So these are the commands you need to know, all commands we've already covered in the lecture video, the IP addresses of each device, and here are the lab tasks. Okay, so there are 11 steps in this one single lab task. So let's go through all of them. First, attempt to ping from PC1 to router 3. Was the ping successful? Why or why not? Okay, so I will open up PC1 and attempt to ping router 3. Let's see if that works. Was it .1.1? Yes. Okay, it seems the ping is not working. Okay, so perhaps router 3 is a internet router, so it is not accepting these pings that have a source IP address that is a private IP address. Okay, on router 4, configure NAT to statically translate PC1's IP address to 180.10.1.15. Okay, so let's do that. So I'll open the CLI of router 4. The password is Cisco. Okay. So let's configure that mapping. IP NAT inside source static, and then PC1's IP address is, here it is, 192.168.1.2, and we will map it to 180.10.1.15. Okay, so we've configured the mapping, but that's not all you need to configure for static NAT, as you know. Okay, which interface should be configured as the inside interface on router 4? Okay, so it should be Fast Ethernet 01. That is the inside interface. And then the outside would be serial 00. Okay, so let's configure those interfaces. Interface Fast Ethernet 01 is the inside. So IP NAT inside and interface serial 00, IP NAT outside. Okay, and let's try that ping again from PC1 to router 3. Okay, it works. Perfect. Okay, let's check that NAT translation table on router 4. Do show IP NAT translation. Okay, so we have the static mapping here. Looks like there are 2 entries for that. I'm not sure about why that is. And then the entry for the ping we just issued. The inside local IP address is translated to what inside global IP address? Well, that's what we just configured, 180.10.1.15. Does the inside global IP address normally represent a public or a private IP address? Well, it normally represents a public IP address because it is the global one. It's what the outside network, for example, the internet, knows. And you can't use private IP addresses on the internet. Okay, step 8 on router 4, configure NAT to statically translate PC3's IP address to this IP, .16. Okay, so let's do that. IP net inside source static 192.168.1.3 is PC3's IP address, and 180.10.1.16. Okay, so display the NAT translation table again. Let's do that. Okay, I can see mappings for both of them. So 192.168.1.3 is map 2.16. Okay, let's try that ping from, well, it says from router 3 to PC 1. Interesting, okay. So I will open up router 3. That is here. Router 3 attempting to ping PC 1. So I think this will not work because it's a router out on the internet trying to ping a public, or sorry, not a public, a private IP address. So that should fail. But let's try. Ping 192.168.1.2. Yes, and that U means unreachable. Okay. Attempt to ping from switch 2 to router 3. From switch 2. Does switch 2 have an IP address? Let's check. Show IP interface brief. Okay, it does have an IP address. But NAT is not configured on router 4 to translate switch 2's IP address. So this should not work. But let me try. Ping 180.10.1.1. Okay, and just like in the beginning with PC1, no NAT is configured for switch 2's IP address, so switch 2 is not able to ping router 3. Okay, so that's all for this lab. I'm going to click on the grade lab function here, and let's see if I did everything correctly. Okay, yes I did. Awesome. Great. And by the way, if you ever have any problems during these labs in NetSim, Boson provides solutions down at the bottom here, with some great explanations, so. Actually, if you want to read these, you can pause the video. I'll scroll through them. Okay, so that was a quick look at a lab in Boson Software's NetSim for CCNA. NetSim has over 100 guided labs like these. Some of them are pretty short and simple, like this one, but then some of them are actually quite difficult and complicated. So I think it's a great study resource, a great labbing resource for the CCNA. If you want to get NetSim, please follow the link in the video description. Before finishing today's video, I want to thank my JCNP level channel members. To join, please click the Join button under the video. Thank you to Anand, Pavel, Abraham, Sergey, Njoku, Victor, Roger, Raj, Kenneth, Seamus, HW, Brandon, Aaron, Marcel, Coney, Donald, Simode, Gustavo, Anthony, Benjamin, Tsepiso, Justin, Prakash, Nasir, Erlison, Marco, Daming, Ed, Value, John, Funny Dart, Velva Jacob, Mark, Yusuf, Boson Software, Devin, Lito, Jonathan, and Vance. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. This is the list of JCNP level members at the time of recording, by the way, March 20th, 2021. If you signed up recently and your name isn't on here, don't worry. You'll be in future videos. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe to the channel, like the video, leave a comment, and share the video with anyone else studying for the CCNA. If you want to leave a tip, check the links in the description. I'm also a Brave verified publisher and accept BAT or Basic Attention Token tips via the Brave browser. That's all for now.